Booktrack brings your favorite stories to life through movie-style soundtracks. Best heard on headphones with high-quality audio settings.
Hachette Audio presents Broken Monsters. Written by Lauren Beukes. Read by Christine Lakin. Terra Deva. Sunil Mohatra. Robert Morgan Fisher. And J.D. Jackson.
I dreamed about a boy with springs for feet so he could jump high. So high I couldn't catch him. But I did catch him. But then he wouldn't get up again. I tried so hard. I got him new feet. I made him something beautiful, more beautiful than you could imagine. But he wouldn't get up, and the door wouldn't open.
Sunday, November 9.
Bambi. The body. The body. The body. The body, she thinks. Words lose their meaning when you repeat them. So do bodies, even in all their variations. Dead is dead. It's only the hows and whys that vary. Tick them off. Exposure. Gunshot. Stabbing. Bludgeoning with a blunt instrument, sharp instrument, no instrument at all when bare knuckles will do. Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, it's murder bingo. But even violence has its creative limits. Gabriella wishes someone had told that to the sick fuck who did this, because this one is unique, which happens to be the name of a sex worker she let off with a warning last weekend. It's most of what the DPD does these days. Hands out empty warnings in the most violent city in America. Dun, dun, dun. She can just hear her daughter's voice. The dramatic horror movie chords Layla would use to punctuate the words. All the appellations Detroit carries, dragging its hefty symbolism behind it like tin cans behind a car marked just married. Does anyone even do that anymore? She wonders. Tin cans and shaving cream? Did anyone ever? Or was it something they made up, like diamonds are forever, and Santa Claus and Coca-Cola Red, and mothers and daughters bonding over fat-free frozen yogurts? She's found that the best conversations she has with Layla are the ones in her head. Detective, the uniform says, because she's just standing there staring down at the kid in the deep shadow of the tunnel, her hands jammed in the pockets of her jacket. She left her damn gloves in the car and her fingers are numb from the chill wind sneaking in off the river. Winter baring its teeth even though it's only November. Are you? Yeah, okay. She cuts him off, reading the name on his badge. I'm thinking about the adhesive, Officer Jones, because mere superglue wouldn't do it. Holding the pieces together while the body was moved. This isn't where the kid died. There's not enough blood on the scene. And there's no sign of his missing half. Black. No surprise in this city. 10 years old, she'd guess. Maybe older if you factored in malnourishment and development issues. Say, somewhere between 10 and 16. Naked. As much of him as there is to be naked. It's entirely possible the rest of him is wearing pants, with his wallet in the back pocket and a cell phone that won't have any minutes, but which will make calling his mama a hell of a lot easier. Wherever the rest of him is. He's lying on his side, his legs pulled up, eyes closed, face serene. The recovery position. Only he's never going to recover, and those aren't his legs. Skinny as a beanbowl. Beautiful skin, even if it's gone yellow from blood loss. Pre-adolescent, she decides. No sign of acne. No scratches or bruises either. Or any indications that he put up a fight or had anything bad happen to him at all. Above the waist. Below the waist is a different story. Oh boy. That's a whole other section of the bookstore. There's a dark gash right above where his hips should be. Where he has been somehow attached to the lower half of a deer, hooves and all. The white flick of the tail sticks up like a jaunty little flag. The brown fur is bristled with dried blood. The flesh appears melted together at the seam. Officer Jones is hanging back. The smell is terrible. She's guessing the intestines are severed on both sets of bodies, leaking shit and blood into the conjoined cavities. Plus, there's the gamey reek of the deer's scent glands. She pities the ME having to open up this mess. Better than the paperwork, though. Or dealing with the goddamn media. Or worse, the mayor's office. Here, she offers, fishing a small red tub of lip gloss out of her pocket. Something she bought at the drugstore on a whim to appease Layla. A candy-flavored cosmetic. That's sure to bridge the gap between them. It's not menthol, but it's something. Thanks, he says, grateful. Which marks him out as an FNG, fucking new guy. He dips his finger in and smears the greasy balm under his nose. Cherry-flavored snot. With sparkles in it, Gabby notices for the first time, but does not point out. Small pleasures. Don't get any on the scene, she warns him. No, I won't. And don't even think about taking any pictures on your phone to show your buddies. She looks around at the tunnel, the graffiti that grows on bare walls in this city like plaque. The weight of the pre-dawn darkness. The lack of traffic. We're going to contain this. They do not remotely contain it.
Last night, a DJ saved my life. Jono is yanked from sleep's deepest tar pits by an elbow to the jaw. He comes up flailing and disoriented, only to find himself fighting bedsheets. The girl from last night, Jen Q, rolls over, her arms flung above her head, revealing the sleeve of tattooed birds that runs up her chest and over her shoulder. She's oblivious to having nearly concussed him. Her eyelids are flickering in REM, caught up in a dream that makes her breath jagged, similar to the panting delight he elicited from her earlier when she was riding him, his hands on her hips. When she came, she flung her head back, flicking her mane of braids. His bad luck to catch one in the eye, which called an abrupt halt to the proceedings as he teared up, blinking in pain. Easy, he says, rubbing her back to bring her out of it. He can feel the dark corona of a hangover hovering around his head, waiting to slam down. But not quite yet. Perversely, the pain from the elbow jab seems to be keeping it at bay. She says, not properly awake. But he's broken through the skin of her nightmare. He runs his palm down the curve of her waist, under the sheets. His cock stirs. That's twice in one night she's heard him. It's entirely possible she'll break his heart next. It was the way she kept saying afterwards, "Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry," but couldn't hold back the giggles, collapsing onto his chest, crying with laughter while his eyes streamed. "That's not exactly a gesture of solidarity," he complained at the time. But the soft weight of her felt sweet, her whole body shaking with laughter. "Do you want to fuck again?" he whispers into her ear now.
"Tomorrow,"
she mumbles, but parts her legs to accommodate his hand anyway.
"It's nice. Keep doing that."
She sighs and rolls over so that he can move in behind her. He pushes his hard-on up against her ass, his finger sliding over her clit until he realizes that her breathing has deepened because she's gone back to sleep. Great. He flops onto his back and looks around the room, but there's not much in the way of clues. One wooden ceiling fan. One scandy modern cupboard. Reedy blinds over the window, their clothes all over the floor. No books, which is troubling if he intends to fall in love with her. Did he tell her that he's a writer? He wonders what the Q stands for. An actual last name or a DJ add-on? Jen X would have been too cutesy, he supposes. Not her style, based on what he has to go on. Which is, to summarize this in one of the easily digestible lists he churns out in lieu of making a respectable living. 1. The set she played last night at the so-called secret party, for which 100 people showed in a studio in Eastern Market under a t-shirt shop. He can't remember the music she was playing, but it was that time of the night when everything merges into doof, doof bass. Two, the way she danced, her braids twisted up on her head to prevent exactly the kind of injury she had inflicted on him. The first thing he noticed, she moved like she was happy, and she smiled when he caught her eye. He liked that. Not too cool to smile. Three, the way she plucked the cigarette impatiently from his mouth when they were outside, still strangers, bound only by the camaraderie of being smokers, having to stand out in the cold with the fuzzy promise of emphysema in the distant future. They'd been talking about Motown and techno, that Rodriguez documentary, the bankruptcy, all the easy conversational set pieces. He thought she was going to take a drag, and instead, she kissed him. Four, making out in her car. There are snapshots in his memory, Instagrams really, because they're blurry around the edges. Following her down a hedged-in alley around the side of a house to a detached cottage, kissing her neck while she messed around with the keys, the smell of her skin making him crazy, swearing, laughing, her sharp shh as the door fell open and they tumbled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.